This is the second most powerful supercomputer on the planet. It is 7,000 square feet of racks, wires, and blinking lights. It has a few hundred thousand times more punch than your laptop. Its name is Sierra. The computer is housed at the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, just east of the San Francisco Bay. It's been up and running for most of 2018, but the lab just recently held an official dedication for it. And we checked it out. We took a tour of the computer room, we got commemorative coins, and experts told us all about the exciting work that Sierra's been doing. It's been modeling earthquakes, doing cancer simulations, exploring traumatic brain injuries, and a lot more. And then,
howdy.
We were all greeted by Rick Perry, the Secretary of Energy for the United States.
To the countless engineers and the technicians, the electricians, designers, and code developers who made Sierra a reality, America applauds your magnificent achievement.
That happened because early next year, Sierra will be air-gapped. That means it'll be completely cut off from any computer network, and it will mostly stop studying earthquakes and brain injuries. It'll turn into a little island of processing power, and its operations will be classified. And that's when its real job begins. Sierra's story begins in 1992 with the last nuclear bomb the United States ever tested. Called Divider, the bomb capped off almost 50 years of nuclear weapons tests and more than 1,000 explosions. Since then, the US has neither tested a nuke nor designed any entirely new warheads. This is thanks in part to a landmark non-proliferation treaty signed by most of the world back in 1970. Among other things, the treaty called for an end to the arms race and a good faith effort to reach complete disarmament. There's been a lot of progress since then, and today the global stockpile is maybe a sixth of what it was in the 80s. But, of course, the US never did disarm entirely. Neither did Russia, or most other nuclear nations. Today, the United States maintains a stockpile of about 4,000 aging yet untestable nuclear weapons, which leaves the government in a bind.
When they were built, they weren't intended to last for 30 to 40 or even 50 years. We were on a cycle of replacing weapons on a regular schedule. A decade or two in the stockpile would be kind of average.
Brian Pudliner is a code physicist at the Livermore Lab. And starting next year, he's going to use Sierra to tackle this catch-22 in our defense policy. As nuclear weapons age past their lifespan, their reliability becomes suspect. But with testing out of the question, it's harder and harder to answer basic but scary questions about our arsenal. If we ever had to use a 40-year-old nuclear missile, would it launch properly? Would it reach its target? Would it explode?
The things that we're concerned about is exactly that, the performance from using the weapon, but also in transporting the weapon, how it's stored. Will it be safe if it falls into the wrong hands? Will its safety features keep it from being used?
Sierra is the latest answer to that problem. All those stacks of processors can simulate questions the military might have about its arsenal. Exactly what questions, that's classified. But as the weapons age, parts degrade and need to be repaired or swapped out. This could be anything from the weapon's enclosure to the core of plutonium sitting inside. Sierra's job will be to model these changes and run simulations to predict whether anything would break in a real-world detonation. And that job? It gets harder the older the bombs are.
As the weapons age and we have to refurbish them to keep them alive for longer, we keep making more and more changes that take them further and further away from what was tested.
One example is the W-80 warhead. They were manufactured as far back as the early 1980s, and the military hopes to keep them online for years to come. But they need work. The conventional explosives used to trigger the bomb's fission stage need to be replaced, but those original compounds have been retired. Sierra needs to simulate new explosives until it finds one that we can trust with a real detonation. One that hopefully will never happen. Sierra's work falls under the government's Stockpile Stewardship Program. Over the years, the program has included 12 other supercomputers, the world's largest laser, and even explosive tests using plutonium. just not enough for a full nuclear chain reaction. We wanted an outside take on all this, so we called Daryl Kimball, the executive director of the Arms Control Association. He's glad that there are no more live nuclear tests, but he hasn't forgotten that big treaty from 1970, that commitment to disarm.
If the United States today, 50 years later, is continuing to seek to maintain its existing stockpile and in some ways improve and upgrade it, as we are, you know, I see that as fundamentally incompatible in the long run with our legal obligation to pursue nuclear disarmament.
Daryl pointed to a nuclear posture review that the Trump administration published this year. He says that the review is bullish on new nuclear capabilities for the military, which means the line could further blur between maintaining old weapons and turning them into new ones.
The door is open in the sense that, you know, we don't have a hard and fast policy against new nuclear warhead designs. This research could, in my view, go in the wrong direction if the policymakers in Washington allow it to.
The researchers at Lawrence Livermore, they don't wade too far into that debate.
What we do is we answer questions for the Department of Energy.
Terry Quinn runs Livermore's entire computing center. And to her, stockpile stewardship is specific and practical.
We get requirements from the military as to what they want these weapons to do, and then we do the analysis of it and whatever experiments and testing we can do, and we run things on computers, and then we give them answers back. They make the decisions. We're here as really scientific and technical experts to answer those questions.
The need for supercomputers isn't going anywhere, and Sierra's successor, El Capitan, is already in the works. It'll be another huge leap forward and another supercomputer reserved for the military.
And they want to do even more complex 3D problems and many, many, many more of them than we believe that we can do on Sierra. And we'll need something that's at least an order of magnitude, which is 10 times bigger in order to carry out those calculations.
For now, Livermore's other science work, the earthquake simulations, the precision medicine, the astrophysics, it'll still happen here and there at Sierra. If there's time, the weapons come first.
As long as we have nuclear weapons, we will need simulation. Being able to predict, you know, if this weapon is around for 100 years, what happens is going to be something that we'll be working on for a while.
For what it's worth, the number one most powerful supercomputer on the planet is called Summit, and it's at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory in Tennessee. It has a similar architecture to Sierra, but it's unclassified, so it spends all its time on biology and astrophysics, basically all the civilian stuff.